Hi, I'm Rebecca Balcarcel. Let's talk about the very challenging poem, The Emperor of Ice Cream, by Wallace Stevens. It starts out with a command. It says, call the roller of big cigars, the muscular one, and bid him whip in kitchen cups concupiscent curds. There's so many k-k-k in that line. I really have fun with that line. But what is this saying? This is the first sentence, the first three lines. Call the roller of big cigars means get that guy to come. The guy who rolls big cigars, bring him over. And have him, bid him, means request him to stir up the milk into ice cream. The concupiscent curds. Now that word concupiscent is really sexy because it means lustful and desirous. And it's a little odd right here in a poem that so far is just about calling a guy to make ice cream. But some people see some sexual imagery with the cigars, roller of big cigars, kind of implying a lot of masculinity there. So, okay, maybe concupiscent curds are now more, the ice cream is a sexy food, or we have the man, you know, working with the milk. And this calls to mind some sensual pleasure. So the first sentence is, bring this guy, call him over. The roller of big cigars, he's muscular, he'll be able to whip the ice cream. Let the wenches dawdle in such dress as they are used to wear. So let the female servants, the servant girls, dawdle, walk around in the dresses that they're used to wearing. So nothing super special, but as they normally dress, let them come. And dawdle has a little bit of a very casual feel to it. If I'm going to dawdle, I'm not going to be in a hurry. So we're going to call the guy who'll make the ice cream. We're going to call these young women. And the word wenches has a bit of a sexual orientation as well. I'm sorry, sexual overtone. Because we already had the cigars, sort of suggestive. Then we had this word concupiscent, which means lustful. And now we have wenches, which should just mean female servant. But like so many words that refer to women, it has been sexualized and now has overtones of the word prostitute. So we have a wench, or I guess it can be a bit of a low term to refer to women who are of questionable virtue. So we have some, yes, suggestive imagery here. Earthly pleasures are on display, we could say. So he says, let the wenches dawdle in such dress as they're used to wear, and let the boys bring flowers in last month's newspapers. All right, so now we're also going to bring boys. And in last month's newspapers, they're going to wrap flowers. It's as if the papers, they're no longer current, you know, they're last week's papers or last month's papers. They're useful for rolling into kind of a cone shape, and you can put the flowers in them. So the boys will bring flowers. Now, with people bringing flowers and all of this sexuality coming through the language, it almost sounds like this poem is going to be about romance. But very soon we find that that's not the case. However, the next couple of lines are a little mysterious, so let's look at those. Let be finale of seem. The only emperor is the emperor of ice cream. Okay, let be finale of seem. All right, finale is the last act, the ending. So the sentence seems to say, let be the end of seem. So seeming has to do with the appearance of something instead of the reality of something. If someone seems to be sad, well, they may not really be sad. They just appear to be sad. Or if someone seems to be happy, we don't know that they truly are happy. So the line is saying, let the reality be the end of appearances. That's my reading of the line. I think it is pointing out the the appearances, the surface, the fakeness, let's get rid of that and let be actually exist, and let's let that be the end of faking it, of seeming anything, of putting on a show, trying to appear something that you're not. No, let's have be. Now this message, it jibes with the modernist project. And by that I mean that modernist poets, the ones who are writing at this first half of the 20th century, are very interested in the image as opposed to describing stuff. They want to actually make the poem have the image in it so that the reader can see for themselves, hear for themselves, taste for themselves the sensory experiences in the poem. And instead, the poet won't be simply describing or alluding to, but the poem itself will be something. And the reader will just experience that reality that the poem brings. So I think this sentence relates back to that idea. Let be finale of seem. Let actuality, let the image, let reality be the ending of all of this appearances and trying to show stuff, but let's actually put the images in the poem. Or in life, let's be real, let's not be fake. Or in our behavior, let's be genuine instead of appearing and posing and pretending. All right, so there's one look at that line. Lots of people have written about that line. Now, even more confusing is the next line. The only emperor is the emperor of ice cream. Now, of course, this line is repeated, and it's also the title, or part of it's in the title. The only emperor is the emperor of ice cream. Well, here I'm going to bring in an idea that comes from Austin Allen, and he writes an article about this poem on the Poetry Foundation website, which I highly recommend you go look up and read. Well, his idea is that this line in the poem refers to a line in Hamlet, Shakespeare's play. And in the play, Hamlet is insulting the king. The king is a bad guy, a murderer, but the king appears to be entirely, you know, royal and fine, but Hamlet knows that the king is actually a crook. So he says, as an insult to the king, that your worm is the only emperor for diet. And this is saying that the worm is above the king in when it comes to diet, because the worm is going to eat the king when the king is dead. So once we're all corpses, we're not at the top of the food chain anymore. We're going to be eaten by worms. So Hamlet insults the king by saying, you're not so great. The worm is going to eat you. And imagine that a fish could even eat of the worm that ate the king, right? And a beggar could eat the fish that ate the worm that ate the king. And Hamlet explains how this is how a king could go through the guts of a beggar. So he's trying to insult the king by bringing him down a notch, poking a hole in all of that pomposity and that position, and reminding the king, you know what? You're going to die. And when you do, you know, the dust that you become might actually end up, you know, going through the guts of a beggar. So this line, the only emperor, perhaps is echoing Hamlet's discussion about the worm being the emperor for diet. Now, the only emperor implies that Stevens is trying to say there is no other kind of emperor except this kind, the emperor of ice cream. Well, what does that mean? If we take a page from Hamlet, maybe it means that whatever kind of earthly power a person might have, they could even be an emperor, and still they would die. Still, they can't be an emperor of anything that's not transitory, melting like the ice cream. Ice cream lasts only a while, and everything that an emperor might be in charge of, like land or armies or position, all these things are going to go away. very likely they'll go away even in the lifetime, but for certain when the emperor dies, the emperor is now without those things. So maybe there is no emperor of permanence. There's only emperor of things like ice cream. Everything you can be emperor of is temporary, just as ice cream is temporary. Possibly that's what's intended here. Another idea might be that you can only be ruler over your own pleasures, that you can't actually govern other people. It's only your own ice cream that you can be in charge of, you know, your own pleasure in your own life. So the only emperor is the person who's in charge of their ice cream, of their own lives, of the substance and pleasure of their lives. Well, that's an idea. I kind of like the other one better, about the temporary stuff that an emperor can rule over. Now, we've spent all this time in the kitchen with the ice cream in this first stanza, but now we're going to have a shock because we're going to see what's going on in another room.